Is it visible? It's visible, right? Both ways. Okay, fantastic.
It's visible, ma'am.
Okay, awesome. So how many students are we expecting to join today?
Ma'am, we have 4 sections of marketing.
Okay. Okay. And Janvi, would you by any chance, are you here?
Yeah, Prachi, I'm here.
Yeah. Would you by any chance know if it's the same set of people that I've spoken to before? Because I've spoken to students at NDIM before, right?
Yeah, this is not the
it's a different batch.
Different batch. Yeah.
Okay, got it. Perfect. Thank you.
Chala sir, shall we wait for 5 minutes before more students join?
I think the students finish their classes at 4:55. So we can give them at least 5 more minutes and then we can start off.
Sure, sir.
Hope that's okay with you, Prachi.
Prachi, you're okay with waiting 5 minutes?
Yeah. I gave a thumbs up. Sorry, I didn't realize. I just assumed camera's on. So
okay. Yes, I noticed.
Cool.
Students, you can just put a message in your respective section groups that they should join ASAP. So Prachi, unless you are covering about Zoom media during your discussions, we can spend this you can talk about that right now till the others join.
Yes, sir. So I'm actually, my first couple of slides are about Zoom India, just so that everybody has context of all the agencies that we have under the ecosystem and therefore what do each of those agencies do. So I will cover that. I obviously, like, makes sense to talk to prospective employees, why not, in terms of, you know, what we can, what they can expect at exploring at the zoo, for sure.
Sure.
So, yeah.
You are based out of which place?
So I'm from Bombay, sir, and I moved to Gurgaon about 5 years ago. And so family is still in Bombay. I basically travel a lot between the cities. Yeah. And last year, somewhere in the middle of last year, I switched to a national role. So I therefore service, like, I work with clients across all three markets. So across Bombay and Gurgaon and Bangalore. So home is a shared concept, I would say. Home is whatever. But mostly for all festive and everything, I'm home. Like, I go home every time I can to see my parents. So, yeah.
How's the situation in Mumbai now?
It's good. I mean, I think Bombay is still very conservative about what is allowed, what is not allowed, and those kind of things. I think Gurgaon at least has opened up. Delhi NCR generally is pretty active, I would say. Bombay, I think, is just being a little too scared.
I thought that, you know, Bombay was more safer as compared to Delhi.
So what happens fundamentally, I think, is that space-wise, Bombay doesn't have space, right? So agar, even if, God forbid, if is in any house situation that it happens, for example, if somebody gets COVID, it's very easy here to isolate that person, right? Because most rooms have like an attached bathroom and like ecosystem which can be set up separately. Versus Bombay, everybody is in very close proximity to each other.
Yeah.
Both from like a public transport plus home plus office situation. So therefore, space plays such a large role in a contagious sort of environment like this, that which is why I think Bombay is a lot more susceptible as compared to Delhi. But safer, yes, they're taking a lot more precautions and as compared to Delhi, like Delhi, Gurgaon, there's a lot of people who are not wearing a mask and not, you know, exercising proper social distancing and those kind of things. But yeah, even though all the rules and regulations are very strict right now in Bombay, it can still happen that, you know, it's more likely to spread there as compared to here.
Yes, no doubt. Space is a very, very big issue in Mumbai. And where is your home in Mumbai?
Our office in Bombay is at Lower Parel. And my home in Bombay is also at Lower Parel. So, yeah. Close by, very close by. I used to live in Dadar, if anybody's from Bombay and they know. We shifted to Lower Parel about a year ago. And so I was so irritated because I, from my bedroom, I can see our office building. And I was just like, ghar pe to chhod do mujhe. Because it was so strange. Because I can literally see our office building straight from, I wake up and the first thing I see is our office building. So I was like, oh God.
I mean, it would be really convenient. I mean, if you can walk down to your office, then, you know.
Correct. That is also not there. The convenience of that is not there because it's on the other side of Lower Parel. Like, it's Bombay is, again, is very
east and the west part.
Yeah, yeah. So I live on the west side of it and office is on the east side. East, so I can see the building, but yeah.
Okay. Sonal, what do you suggest? Can we begin now? Because we are already...
If Prachi can give us the go ahead, we may start.
Yeah, I'm okay. You tell whenever. I'm always willing to start talking.
Okay, so let's start the session. A very good evening to all of you. On behalf of New Delhi Institute of Management, we welcome you all to today's session. The topic for today's session is understanding the construct of an advertising agency. To give us an insight on this particular topic, we have with us Ms. Prachi Bali. She's a national head, client partnership and business head of Northern Region, Foxy Moran. She joined the company as an account manager in 2013, where she rose rapidly to the rank of account director. In 2016, she moved to Gurgaon as one of the agency's world's youngest business head of Northern Asia and, you know, spreading the business like a fire. Over the past 3 years, she has grown the business 6 times in the market, making her force to be reckoned with her experience. She has experience in verticals such as FMCG, electronics, manufacturing, entertainment, to name a few. Now, may I request Ms. Prachi to please begin her session. Ma'am, we welcome you at NDIM.
Thank you so much for the introduction and thank you so much for having me. It's always a pleasure to be able to speak to students because I remember being a marketing student not very long ago, and it was the best part, of course, was always having industry come and talk to us and engage with real-time information and live information, so to speak. So I think it's great and I'm really happy and lucky that I can do this with as many platforms and as many opportunities that you guys give us. So thank you for having us and thank you for always being so warm towards the zoo as well. I'll jump into the presentation, and I have prepared, you know, a bunch of slides which broadly take you through what it takes and what advertising agencies are comprised of. And then I typically like to have a lot of questions hopefully being answered, because I just think that's the best way to interact and have, you know, more real life questions or most direct questions being answered. So I'll hopefully leave a lot of time at the end for questions. But yeah. Okay, fantastic. I hope everybody can see my screen and hear me clearly as well. In case there's anything, please let me know. So I belong to a network of agencies called the Zoo Media Network. Zoo Media is India's first homegrown media network, and we have 7 agency brands within our network. Why we are the first homegrown is because we've actually been able to build a functioning and expertise-driven network of agencies within the Indian ecosystem. What otherwise exists in a lot of global networks, so like the Group M's and the WPPs and the, you know, IPGs of the world. We don't have any such global affiliation, and so therefore we actually went about crafting our own network, and that's why we're India's first homegrown network. So typically, just to give you some sort of context, when you look at these global networks, they are divided based on scale. So what I mean by that is that you're generally forming multiple agencies to bring about duplicity. So you would take on an Idea business and a Vodafone business and an Airtel business, and that would typically rest with 3 different agencies. And so that's how you set up agency brands to handle competing contracts within the market. Versus our approach was left of center because we're foxy, but our approach was more towards creating agency ecosystems which specialize in different aspects of digital. So we are a out and out digital media marketing company and network, and all of us provide therefore those different kinds of expertise in each of our network agencies, which goes into specific verticals, and therefore we can deliver different kinds of solutions for the brands that we handle across the board. So I'll talk to you guys a little bit about each of these agencies, and I'd be happy to, as I said, take on specific questions towards the latter half of the session. So first and foremost is Foxy Moron. I'll go into a little bit of depth for Foxy Moron later in the presentation, because that's the typical agency situation happens inside Foxy. I'll go through the others in the network. So Doinoink Consulting is our consulting vertical. So the reason we created this and what it does is it is in charge of digital transformation of brands. What that means, if I de-jargonify it, is that today in India, there are a lot of Indian-owned businesses, there are a lot of startups, there are a lot of small business owners who are taking their regional brands national. And for these kind of markets and clients, for these kind of clients in our market, There needs to be an agency or a service which helps them get onto digital, because there's a lot of information, and this kind of information generally either confuses clients and stakeholders, or it is something that, you know, they usually need assistance with. So DOC or Doinoink Consulting is our consulting arm, which competes with the likes of a Deloitte and an Accenture and you know, an Edelman and sorts. But we do it in a much more competitive, digital first sort of a way. And therefore we work with a lot of startups and Indian owned brands which are between funding, brands which are between MVPs and funding, and those kind of situations. Also, if there is something that, let's say a brand wants to do certain market research to decide what their vision for the brand is for the next 3 years. So a DOC would step in to do market research, to understand the sentiment of consumers, to analyze and study the kind of data that exists within competition, within category, and therefore within consumer, and be able to build a go-to-market strategy for that brand for that reason. So that in a nutshell is kind of what DOC does, which is our consulting arm. Next, we have Polyn. So Polyn is our influencer, talent, and content creator consultancy vertical. And to break that up into three parts. So we do influencer management, which is typically where a brand briefs us and we look at providing different kinds of influencer services, whether it's macro, celebrity, micro, nano, different types of influencers that work for your brand or that work for that specific brief. Other than that, Polyn also does talent management. So we have like a joint venture with Dharma Cornerstone, where we have different kinds of celebrities, sports people, different kinds of content creators as well on board. And we manage them as talent. So what that means is we take these talent and these creators and we work with them to take them to different brands and therefore satiate different needs. So almost represent that talent on digital. That becomes one of the services, core services that Polyn offers. And thirdly is that we do content creator consultancy. So what that means is today we live in a world surrounded by influencers and there are a lot of them who do different things. You know, they specialize in different verticals. They do different types of content on different platforms. So sometimes when they get stuck in terms of what they should do next or what their brand should signify or represent, or even what they should be doing from a consumer facing point of view in the long-term gestation, that is where Polyn steps in to help consult with them and to almost give them like strategic directions forward. So that in a nutshell is the trifecta of services that Polyn provides. Next, we have the rabbit hole, of course, inspired by Alice in Wonderland going into the rabbit hole. So the rabbit hole is our production house and they do end-to-end production, right from smaller animated kind of videos and brand edits to larger TVCs, DVCs, and productions, larger billboards, those kinds of things. So for example, Rabbit Hole also has clients of its own, so does Polyn. So Cred, if any of you have seen the Cred campaigns, so the Rahul Dravid film that happened, Polyn was the one which amplified it across the digital ecosystem by working with Kohli, by working with, you know, Kumble, by working with different kinds of digital celebrities. Rabbit Hole on the other side has clients such as Netflix, Tinder, Bumble, Pepperfry. So all of the content that you see inside Netflix, whether if it is something like AK versus AK, if it is something like Behensplaining, if it is something like, you know, any of the editorial content that you see that is produced by Netflix in India, essentially everything on their YouTube channel and everything on their social media channels, that's completely managed by by Rabbit Hole from end to end. So therefore, we are a strategic and a video solutions agency rather than just a simple straight cut production house. So that again, therefore, entails, you know, in terms of the composition of the team, of course, you'll have your editors, you'll have your producers, you'll have line producers, you'll have sound editors, video producers, directors, ADs, so on and so forth. But we also have an entire layer of strategists and video solution thinkers. What I mean by video solutions is today, videos are not just TVCs or DVCs, but they also become instruments of performance. So what I mean by that is if my product is selling on Amazon, I can show a YouTube video which directs the consumer to Amazon. So that piece of content, which is a 6-second piece of content, is not necessarily a brand film. It is a specific business objective driven film. So which is why Rabbit Hole also specializes in creating video solutions for the network and for Foxy clients and not just creating only film and standalone productions. Next, we have Mammoth Studios. So within Mammoth, we have two aspects of Mammoth Studios. One is Mammoth Media and one is Mammoth Studios. So Mammoth Studios essentially is the home of all long format content for the zoo. What I mean by long format content is everything you see on OTT platforms, right? right from the kind of shows that you see on Amazon Prime or Eros or Netflix or any of the hot Disney Hotstars of the world. So therefore, what Mammoth Studios does is we have essentially a writer's room where we create and curate these scripts from all over the country and then work with different OTT platforms to either sell them these or co-create these kind of IPs with them. So that's what, in a nutshell, Mammoth Studios does. What Mammoth Media does is Mammoth Media launched our first publisher network. So we are moving from becoming just media advertisers to media owners as well. So just the way you have, let's say, the Times of India Network online, right, where they have all their different websites for all their different verticals. We forayed into this field for the first time earlier last year. And so therefore, we've created a website called Man's Life, which talks about sports, auto, entertainment, and grooming for men. And it covers and showcases all the different elements and all the cool things that are happening in the universe and ecosystem of men in India today. And therefore, we want to work on a content community and commerce model. What that means is you create content which builds a community loyal to it and works with it. And then therefore you be able to build in commerce as a service within that same community as well. So essentially helping brands speak to consumers who are really interested in a particular type of content, therefore in a particular mindset, and therefore being able to target their communication a lot better, both from a media point of view and also from a communication point of view. Second to last, we have Noesis Tech. So Noesis Tech is an end-to-end tech firm, which we acquired about 3 to 4 years ago. They have been in existence for over 11 years now. And they do, again, everything from landing pages and microsites to complicated web apps, e-commerce websites, standalone mobile applications, and the works. So Noesis Tech is our solution to everything and anything related to technology. And that's what Noesis does from end to end, is creates these kind of solutions, which are enabled by tech and are also enabling different companies to do cooler, way better, more optimized, create more optimized solutions. Finally, we have Phosphine. Phosphine is our creative tech agency. What that means is anything which is to do with consumer technology, consumer facing technology, such as chatbots, augmented reality, virtual reality, face filters, playable ads, shoppable ads. All of these kind of consumer-facing technology pieces are helmed and reside within Phosphine. So anything that's innovative and cool and fun to do is what Phosphine covers. I'll come now to Foxy Moron. So Foxy is the original brand which started all this. So Foxy is more than 13 years old now, 13 and a half. And over the course of years, of course, Foxy has worked across different brands and across different clients. What Foxy started off being was just a simple social media agency, because that time Facebook was something new that brands wanted to explore. Today, it has become a business driver, a solution provider, and a core end-to-end digital agency. So when we say end-to-end, what that means is every and any need that the client can have with regards to digital is what Foxy Moron fulfills. And that's the strength of it. What Foxy Moron consists of is, of course, the account management team, the creative team. Creative team composes of copy and art both, an SEO team, an ORM team, and a media team. So Foxy essentially becomes the client-facing, the retainer agency out of the network. And we work across over 50 brands today across the ecosystem. So yes, that's what we do. And yeah, I think I hope so clear so far, and I'll move on to going further in. So the zoo, we have 3 offices across the country. We have a Bombay office, as I was saying, Lower Parel. We have Gurgaon, which is based out of Sector 44. And we have Bangalore, which is our 3rd office. And the zoo pretty much sits across these 3 offices, no matter which agency you belong to. From a branch ecosystem, we operate out of these 3 branches and we share the same office space. I wanted to spend a little bit of time, I usually do, on vision, mission, and values. I feel like, because it's important for, especially when you're making decisions which are going to, in the future, impact your career, for you to have a forward-facing outlook in terms of what is the kind of place that you want to work in and align with, right? So when we look at our vision at Foxy and at the zoo, our vision is to build a network, which is the preferred partner to leading businesses that maximizes potential by providing the most impactful solutions through future-ready products and services. Now, while that's a mouthful, I understand, what are the key takeaways from this that, you know, I would analyze for any company that I want to join is, our vision was always to build a network, which is great because that's what we're in the process of doing. And we want to be preferred partners. What that means when it comes to advertising in general is that the client and you should have such a good relationship and it should be such a strong business relationship that whenever they have any kind of requirement or need, the first people that they think of is you as an agency. That I believe is a strong testament to not just the relationship that you have with the client, but also the business results that you're delivering for that client. Of course, we want to work with leading businesses across, whether it is leading in a category or leading in a country or leading in a particular consumer set. We want to work with leading businesses in the market so that we can, you know, truly maximize the potential and the kind of results that we can drive for them. And we're always focused on impact driving solutions through future-ready products and services. So just to give you an example of that, while Alexa and Echo and all these bots are coming, voice solutions are coming up, we actually started pitching voice to our clients 3 years ago in 2018, 2019, saying, guys, this is going to be the next wave of the future. And this is something that, you know, clients must invest in and you should invest in because your consumer trend is moving or will move at some point in that direction. So when we say future-ready products and services, we always work really hard to be ahead of the curve and to try and provide something that clients have either never seen before or not understood before or not been enabled to. A lot of times clients understand a lot of things, but they're not as simple necessarily for them as they can be or they should be. Next, in terms of mission, right? Mission is nothing but the way that you work and the kind of culture that you're building. So you want to foster a culture of expertise that weaves in consulting, content, media, tech, which creates holistic solutions through collaboration amongst the network and data-backed processes for organizations that demonstrate ambition through thought leadership, ambition and thought leadership. So again, if you marry the vision with the mission, right, we do want to work with leading businesses, but we also want to work with good people. We want to work with good people who want to do good and who are ambitious and brands that really want to change the face of either digital or change the face of the brand using digital, because that's what we take pride in. We take pride in our work. And that's something that, you know, we wanted to be, taken very seriously when it comes to the kind of people that we want to work with and the kind of work that we want to do all in all. So I think the mission, vision, therefore, from that perspective become very important to an agency. In terms of values, so we have something fun, which we call the Ice Cube. So it's ICEEE. So we just said Ice Cube, why not? And these values are something, I think regardless of whether you're looking at an advertising agency or you're looking at any profession in general, I always say that this is a great set of qualities, so to speak, that you should have in yourself before you embark on the journey of becoming a working professional. Because I think work can be a lot of fun. And I've been in this agency for over 8 years and I love the agency, but it can never come at the cost of work. It can never come at the cost of work ethic. And it can never come at the cost of your personal ethics as well. So which is why I always encourage, especially students, to, you know, understand that working is not just a job. It is just a job in terms of how much time you devote to it. But the quality of the input is always going to determine the quality of your career and therefore the output that you receive and the rewards that you receive. And the value of strong work ethic goes a long way. If you have that right from the beginning, you'll always be appreciated. You'll always be encouraged and you'll always be respected. Regardless of your designation or what role you're playing. If you have a strong work ethic, it always goes a long way. So just a little bit about these, each of these values and why we chose them. So integrity for us, as I said, it's all about ethics. For us, it is the number one rule that we follow at the zoo that no matter what, we always expect each of our stakeholders to work with the highest sense of ethics and the highest sense and integrity, therefore, is something that we don't compromise on. Whether it's towards our clients, whether it's towards our internal stakeholders, whether it is to anybody, our employees or our management or whichever way, integrity is something we hold very close to our heart and consider one of our core values. Second is creation. So it's not just, it's great to be pitching a lot and to be creating these, having these crazy ideas. But we think that the value of creation is something that you need to hold very dear to you, because it's not just about making great presentations. It's also about being able to take those and like take those live and to be able to deliver on those kind of campaigns, products, results, whichever aspect of it you look at. So the spirit of creation is something which we hold very dear as well. Like, we really believe that every person is creative. There is no separate, like, copy and art are functioning departments, of course, but every person working in an ad agency has the power and the lacuna and the skills to be creative. Next is endurance, which is the first of our E's. And this is something that, you know, people who work at Foxy are notorious for, but we really take pride in the people we work with being a part of our family, being a part of our ecosystem. We take our teams very close to ourselves and we treat them like family in that way as well. And so therefore, endurance is not just about, you know, it's not about long hours. It's not about working weekends. It's about what can you do in your capacity to keep delivering the best for your clients. B, what can you do in your capacity to enhance the output of your team and to be there for your team and to help them overcome their challenges that they may be facing? And finally, endurance is about standing by the organization and making sure that you're delivering on all the results that you want to, or, you know, delivering on the vision of the organization for that, those clients as well. So endurance for me personally also is one of my core values, and it is one of the core values of the zoo as well. Striving for excellence. So never be satiated with whatever level you're at or whatever sort of, you know, designation you're at or whatever you've achieved. Always continue to do more, do better for yourself, for your company, for your team, for your own career and for your brand. And always continue to raise the bar, for sure. Empathy, I think, is the last, but definitely not the least. That always, always remember that there is a situation behind everything that's happening. There's always a point of view that the opposite person has. So make sure that you keep that in mind, no matter who you're talking to in a professional capacity. Always have that at the back of your head, that maybe someone's just had a bad day. Maybe someone's had bad news. Maybe someone is really feeling uncomfortable with certain things. Maybe they're really out of depth. So always remember that empathy, a little bit of empathy takes you a long way in any kind of professional career. A snapshot of some of the clients that we've worked with. There are, of course, many more. I think over the course of the last 13 years, we've worked with over 1,000 clients across different categories and across different verticals. And yeah, we're very, very proud to go from being a nobody and being like a company started by 4 boys out of a mill in Bombay to being the network that we are today. And we wear our clients like our badges of honor because it's truly like it's beautiful. Like I look at it sometimes and I speak to my teams and I'm like, when I was an account manager, I was lucky that I had one brand that my parents knew. Like, they knew the name of L'Oreal Paris, so I could explain to them ke wo Aishwarya Rai wala brand, right? All my other brands were brands that nobody knew of. Like, I was selling cupcakes for a startup, like for a local restaurant. So it's not like Foxy became Foxy overnight. It's a long journey that, you know, we've undertaken as an agency, as a team also, to constantly keep achieving better and better results and therefore landing some of the best clients and being fortunate enough to work with some of the best clients across the country. So Foxy, which is our what we're here to talk about, the integration of content, media, data, and tech. And yeah, a little bit about Foxy. As I said, there was 4 boys who started this as a summer project in college. And slowly it became like a thriving business. We started off doing like corporate merchandising and Facebook and social and those kind of things. And today, of course, we have business conversations with all of our client partners in different kind of ways. And that's how it came alive. And that's where it is today. Across the course of years, I don't think there's any industry that we haven't worked in. Pretty much all different kinds, whether it's from FMCG to aviation, to government and CSR clients, lots of BFSI, Alcobev, pretty much across the length and breadth of industries, we've worked across them on digital. So coming to what this session is about, right? So what exactly do agencies do? I'm sure a lot of you are either studying it in some format or the other, or have been exposed or have researched it in some format or the other. So what exactly do agencies do? So typically there are this is the easiest one that I could find out of the kind of services that you would expect, not from a service point of view, but what is the kind of objectives that clients have when it comes to working with an agency. So first of all is the most important, which is increasing brand awareness, whether you're launching a new brand or you're launching a new product or you're launching any kind of new proposition or service. Brand awareness is generally the most common objective that you see coming out. Second could be standing out from competition. So a lot of times when you have aggressive brands, such as let's say the OTT space, or you look at telephone, so OEM providers, phone companies, their objectives are usually geared towards being one up or one better than the competition. And therefore that's what attracts the consumer. So for them, it's not that much about brand awareness, but it's about differentiating from competition. Third thing is, of course, attracting potential customers. So customers, whether it is exploring different types of consumer cohorts. So today with digital, what happens is that what used to happen with television is, of course, you're advertising on Channel V or you're advertising on Star Sports. You are assuming that everybody at home is watching it, but you can't really speak to the different family members. So father, mother, grandparents, and kids, you can't speak to them differently. Digital as a medium allows you to do that. And which is why this third objective exists, right? Because it's not just spray and pray, but digital can be very targeted towards specific target audiences. And therefore, that's the exciting and cool thing about digital also, that you get to be in an ecosystem where you are taking a campaign or you're taking a product and you can find new people who want to consume that product or want to become consumers of that, customers of that brand or that product in the future. Fourth one that would be educating your business customers. This is more from a B2B lens. So a lot of times objectives for digital can also be that I am a particular manufacturer and I manufacture these tiles and I have a retail business, but I also want to speak to my distributors using digital, whether it's through a WhatsApp campaign or an incentivized campaign or whatever. Like, for example, we created a game for Swiggy with their riders. They wanted to do an engagement-driven campaign and an incentivization for all the people who are like their rider boys in different markets. So we created like a virtual experience and a game for them to interact with and therefore achieve that objective. Versus if we have a brand called Orient Belt Tiles, which is in obviously tiles. So they compete with the Kajarias and the Somanis of the world. And they wanted to create, and they have created different tech solutions, which specifically reach out to different B2B providers. So they help architects and interior designers and contractors to enable their customers to do better and make easier choices and so on and so forth. So digital can also therefore be used to speak to your B2B customers. Fifth objective, and again, very, very important, is increasing sales volume and ROI. So because digital has such a much higher level of attribution than mainline formats, there is a great objective that overlies, which what we call performance marketing. So when you say performance marketing, that's what it's geared towards, which is increasing the amount of sales that a brand does online. And of course, the ROI. So what's the return on investment that you're getting? Second to last is improving brand image. A lot of times you have brands which either don't do really well, or they've gone through some crazy backlash, or they've just been penalized for something or the other. So a lot of times companies use the aid of digital to kind of look at, or any agency also for that matter, to look at how they can improve the brand image in any particular domain, in a market, following a particular crisis, whichever way. And finally, seventh is supporting other business operations. So what I mean by that is, if you have, let's say, one of our clients for Noesis Tech, they had a manufacturing plant somewhere close to Delhi, but their inventory management system wasn't digitized. So there was still a lot of physical paperwork involved in their inventory management system. So actually using digital, we created an inventory management system for them, which spoke to all their other digital softwares that they were using, and also spoke to the factory and the plant and so on and so forth. So any kind of other business operations, whether it's right from human resources to technology, is also something that digital can enable as objectives. Now, if you look at the traditional ecosystem, if you look at all of these services, so typically you would have one client sitting at the center and they would be working with four or five different agencies. And each of these agencies provide different things. So one agency provides web and graphic and SEO and media campaigns and analytics. One agency is for public relations. One is for video production separately. You have someone for direct marketing and media buying, and you have someone for production, printing, and copy. So now if you look at this, what clients, this is where the network ecosystem for us was born, because why should a client have to deal with multiple agencies when they can work with one partner who can tie all of these things in together, right? So that's what essentially the way that the agencies today, not just us, but the way that generally the market is functioned, is you want to become a one-stop shop for all clients. You want to be able to give them that one house under which all of their needs are going to get provided and taken care of. So this is where, just to kind of throw it back, right? This is why our network exists in this way, so that the client doesn't have to be like that slide. To look at, I could broadly categorize agencies into these six types today, at least from a marketing lens. You have the mainline agency, which is your traditional setup, which does TV, print, outdoor. You have media-only agencies, which only do online and offline buying and planning of media. Media being all the inventory, right? So the spots that you essentially advertise on. You have digital agencies like ourselves, which do everything and anything on digital. You have social media agencies. So you have agencies which specifically look at only social media marketing. They don't provide any of the other services that we provide, but only social media out of those. So maintaining a brand's Facebook, Instagram, those kind of things. You have public relations, so PR agencies, which do everything from managing the celebrities to managing your internal stakeholders to hopefully managing also business leaders within the organization. And finally, I have club branding, creative and boutique agencies as one, because you do have these very credible standalone outfits which only do branding or only do creative work. So they don't touch anything else. They don't get into execution. They're only responsible for managing the branding and the visual and the creative element for a particular brand. And that's all that they do. They don't provide any direct to consumer services. So for the benefit of this presentation, the larger group, I have broken down the first three because the others are pretty much overlapping in some way or the other. When you look at the mainline ad agency, broad strokes, the four departments that they're composed of. So client servicing becomes, of course, the main point of contact between the client and the agency. They are responsible for getting the briefs, debriefing the internal teams, and also going and proposing all the different solutions that the agency comes up with to the client. And of course, any kind of feedback and any kind of changes that they need to incorporate is done by the client servicing agency. They become the gateway for the client into the agency. Next, you have the planning vertical. So planning vertical works with primary data, secondary data, tertiary data, owned data, and also acquired data. So basically lots of data that they work with across the brand and across all the resources that they have access to in order to come up with a plan from, what does that research mean? And therefore, what's the consumer insight? So there in a mainline agency, the planning team's job is to arrive based on all the statistics and the facts that they know and that they're aware of. What is the core consumer insight that has to be worked on from a communication point of view? So they bring it till the stage before communication steps in. And then communication obviously is broken down into copy and art. So the words and the visuals. So the copy and the art teams then will take that particular consumer insight that the planning team has provided and create campaigns or create a key visual or create a, one line out of it from a mainline point of view, because that's how those teams are structured. If I look at a media specific agency, now how a media specific agency is different is that you have, you have four core verticals. You have the business team, which mainly becomes the client facing team. They are not servicing because media doesn't require that much servicing. It's pretty much objective numbers, very quantitatively heavy driven. So when you have a business team, they bring in new business and they handle client relationships and expectations as well. You have the planning team, which is different from the mainline planning team. This planning team plans the media. So they are responsible for planning different kinds of, so they will do deals with different vendors. They will do deals with different publishers and actually create media plans and therefore plan that section of media for the clients. And you have the buying team. So the buying is responsible for the actual buying and the running of the campaigns and the ads. So they will be the ones who are actually executing the media campaigns, whether online or offline. And finally, you have a strategy team. So the strat team in this case designs what the product is. So when you have larger briefs, you have annual plans, you have, as I said, like what is the future of media for this client or for this category. Those are the kind of briefs that your strat team will typically work on. And they will come out with whatever output that is best suited from a media point of view. Finally, you have a digital agency, which is like us, which is like Foxy Moron. So you have the account management team. So account management team in this case plays almost like a dual role of client servicing plus planning. In the sense, they don't go into the depths that a planning agent, like a planning team in a mainline agency would go to, but they of course refer to a lot of primary information, secondary information. They assist the other teams within the ecosystem to capitalize and build on opportunities that the clients present to us. And they also, of course, interface with the client on a regular basis. So they work very closely and directly with the client to use the other services that the agency provides. Then you have the copy and the art team, which is pretty self-explanatory in terms of copy does copy and art does art. You have the media team. So the media team is responsible for media planning, buying, and optimizing. Within a digital ecosystem, a media team is responsible. So the planning and the buying feature is not necessarily split up. When it comes to media, it is on the same page and within the same department. And so that's your media team, which does all of these fixed buys, optimized buys, all different kinds of buys for digital campaigns. You have the SEO team, which is the search engine optimization team. They provide, of course, they help brands and they work very closely with the tech team and the web team in order to get the websites of the clients to rank higher on Google. That's what SEO does. And therefore that builds credibility for the website and that builds credibility therein for the brand as well. That also assists a lot with search. So Google search is obviously all of us use search. We search for something at least once a day, right? So the results that show up over there and how high up my brand shows is in a nutshell what search engine optimization is. It's a functional expertise. So there are experts who do this and they know how to do this. And therefore that is the setup in that way. Finally, we have the ORM and social listening department. So ORM is online reputation management and SL is social listening. What ORM and social listening does, they work hand in glove. So social listening by using certain tools, it crawls the digital ecosystem to find out what are the conversations that are happening around either certain keywords or your branded keywords or any keywords that you have flagged off or tagged. They then input those and what the ORM team or the online response team does is they respond to those from a brand voice. So either you can have like a branded handle, which is tweeting back or answering back, or you can have like different kinds of, customers who are replying and you can have a complete strategy around ORM for that as well. So ORM and social listening, therefore, looking at what conversations are going on the internet and responding to those from a branded handle or a brand POV is what the ORM and social listening team does. Just to give you a little bit of insight into the structure and the hierarchy, again, like what to expect when you're getting into an agency. These are the grades that we follow at least, and it's very common. I've seen mostly a lot of people comply to these. Of course, there are anomalies. Somebody will call it a leader, team leader instead of a manager. Somebody will call it like a, different people, like different agencies have different nomenclatures, but roughly it's the same. So a junior executive is typically like an entry-level resource within the ecosystem who works on typically one or two brands at most. And they handle their daily work and they handle, their daily comings and goings. And this can be across creative, art, copy, whichever. You have a senior executive, typically would be a little more experienced than that person. So with a couple of years of at least work experience before. Then you have an associate manager. An associate manager is somebody you're training to become a manager. So you would give them sole custody of, let's say, a couple of brands or a couple of big brands. And they are to manage end-to-end. So while your junior and a senior executive are mainly looking at regular retainer work, your associate manager would start working on and looking at larger projects also. So probably media projects, probably SEO projects, probably influencer projects, so on and so forth. You have a manager level person. So the manager essentially looks at 3 to 4 brands holistically, so wholeheartedly. So they have complete ownership of 3 to 4 brands, 3 to 4 minimum. This can also go up to 5 to 6, depending on the agency and the size of the brands that you're looking at. Then you have the account associate director. Associate director is director in waiting again. So where you're training them for the next role, which is that of a director. An associate director could handle 5 to 6 brands by themselves. Again, depending on scale and nature. And finally, you have the director. So the director would lead the entire cluster, whether it is for art, account management, or copy. They would be the sort of head of that team of that cluster for those brands. And finally, lastly, you have head of department. Now, head of department can be business head for a branch. Head of department can be functional head for a for let's say copy or like an NCD level person. Head of department could be a head for strategy. It could be any of these verticals, functional or business, have HODs, which could be business leaders or functional expertise leaders across the board. I'm coming basically towards the end of my presentation, and I think the zoo culture is a great way to talk about that. We love our teams, and we are very proud and of our teams when we all win awards, and we love taking risks. I think we're like notoriously known in the like within clients for always speaking our minds and always just saying it as it is. We don't have any kind of formal culture, you know, cabin or whatever. Like right now also, if the where I'm sitting is, we all sit together. Like there are 7-8 of us who sit together. There are no walls. Even our founders, you know, they don't have cabins or anything. Or even if they do have cabins, it's mainly just to keep their bags. I think everybody except for them uses their cabins to do calls and to do things like that. They are pretty much roaming around the office talking to everyone. So yeah, I mean, this is, we have a no cabin culture. We love hanging out with each other. So we do have crazy offsites, you know, lots of food, lots of celebrations, lots of parties, lots of music. We don't take ourselves too seriously. I think that's one of the cool things about the company is that we take our work very seriously, but we don't take ourselves too seriously because otherwise there's no fun in whatever it is that we're trying to do. And of course, we are big on festivals, no matter which ones. We just need an excuse to have fun and to be together and to eat some great food. We're very centered around food. It's called the Foxy Five. So when you join immediately in the next 2-3 months, you put on 5 kilos. It's like a standard rule. Everyone goes through it. The Foxy, the notorious Foxy Five. And yeah, that's just a bunch of us a couple of years ago when we had our last offsite. Of course, unfortunately, due to the pandemic, we haven't had one. But that's what we are. We love what we do and we love each other, which is why we love doing what we do. And that's it. And I think I like to sign off my sessions with this poem, If. And I think this is, it's a beautiful poem. It's something so old, but so true, regardless of which age you're at or what you're trying to do in life. Google it, read it, understand the lines, and it will be applicable to you in some format or the other, someday or the other. So just, I take this as something that I always look back at and be like, yeah, it's going to be okay. You know, there's a lot more that I have to grow into and there's a lot more that I can do and I can work on myself for. So yeah, that's what I look at. And finally, yeah, I think a part of what I was saying in the Foxy culture part, right, was that we take our work very seriously, but we don't take ourselves very seriously, because I think that's one of the keys to constantly being grounded. No matter what you've done and no matter what you've achieved, you're a part of a larger ecosystem. It's the team that wins. It's never an individual sport. Advertising is not an individual sport by any means. And so you're only going to be successful if you're successful as a part of a team. And that's always respected and always something that, you know, we love, any agency would love hearing is, would love having different team players on board as well. And yeah, always, no matter where you're going, be present. Leave your phones aside for whatever it is that you're doing. Enjoy your meals. Enjoy the company, just truly enjoy whatever it is that you're doing at whatever moment in time. I think phones are the biggest distractions in our lives, and it's up to us to take those away and actually focus on being present, no matter what you're doing, whether it's this or something else after this. Just enjoy it and have fun. That's me. I am good on time, I think.
Thank you so much, Prachi. I think it was an interesting presentation. And, you know, I was just trying to recollect that, you know, I started my career about 35 years back in the mm-hmm. IT sector. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I saw it, you know, growing. And I mm-hmm. think you started with digital marketing and you have seen it growing.
Yes.
You know, we used to talk about, you know, finally, we used to talk about turnkey selling, you know, where, yes. you know, it's a one-stop solution for yes. all the aspects related to IT solutions.
Exactly.
And today you're talking about, you know, the zoo being, you know, the amalgamation of these 7 different agencies.
mm-hmm.
you know, kind of, you are the, you know, the turnkey solution to all the digital needs.
That's the hope, sir. That's the hope. We try.
Yeah, yeah. Because, you know, digital marketing has actually grown over these so many years.
Yes.
And, you know,
yes.
and every field has become very, very specific. So naturally, you need to grow in every field. And that's mm-hmm. what you're doing. So congratulations. And we wish you all the best.
Thank
and,
you, sir.
And, you know, so there's a question which has come up from Vaishnavi.
Yes, and she I can says, see it.
Yeah. So Foxymoron helps brands to stand unique in crowd.
Mm-hmm.
What helps Foxymoron to stand out and unique from its competitors?
So Vaishnavi, for that, I would definitely say it's our culture. It has always been our culture. We have so many people who work with us for a couple of years. They leave, go outside, work with other people, like other agencies, and then come back. Literally, like my creative director right now in the North has just come back. I have a creative director in Bombay who's come back. It's been something that's always been I've never left, so I don't know what to call it separately, but everybody gives me the same reason, which is it feels like home. There is something about Foxy which is just so special because everyone works together and everyone makes mistakes and learns together, and everybody pretty much just, we do it for the people, we do it for each other more than anything else. And I think that for me is what makes us stand out, is culture from Foxy. And I think from a larger point of view, if I look at it strategically for an employee, what is exciting is if you're getting into an ecosystem where everything is in-house. So if you look at the zoo, right, which is why I showed the different agencies, all these agencies are ours. They're not external vendors that you're working with. So I spent a great deal of time, effort, energy early on in my career trying to coordinate with a lot of people outside. What happens there is twofold. One is logistics. Of course, it takes time, money, effort, all of that. But secondly, more importantly, is it's very difficult to align their thought process with what you're thinking. A lot of times that gap exists. If they don't belong to the same ecosystem, or if they don't sort of belong to the same archetype and thought process. So yeah, that's what I think. Those are the two things that help Foxy stand out.
Yeah, so I think having everybody under the same roof gives you better control over the entire solution.
For sure. Like everybody definitely, because of the zoo, right? And it's, that's what the thing, like you can have any and every requirement that a client could want in a particular campaign or in a brief or whatever. And we have the wherewithal to answer that and to work on that and better it as well. So exactly. Those would be, I think that's the fun also, because you don't have to travel a lot. You don't have to go find vendors. You can just pick up the phone on somebody inside the system and say, acha, does this work? Does this not work? Whichever way.
Correct. Multi-speciality digital agency.
Kind of. Yes, sir.
Right.
Yes. There's another question. What are the required skills on freshers level to join digital agency? I would say I would definitely look at some sort of understanding of how the platforms work. So I would definitely obviously encourage people to study a little more in the, I don't mean just studying, but I mean studying like the actual platform. So whether it's Twitter has Twitter Flight School, Facebook has Facebook Blueprint, you have Google has Google's own workshops and seminars. So getting that kind of actual tool-based knowledge, I call these tools, but technology-based knowledge, whatever way you look at it, that helps a lot to help stand out from the crowd. And other than that, yeah, of course, I would say a general background in marketing always helps if you have it. It makes the conversation a lot easier, that at least if you have the foundation and the fundamentals laid in, then that helps. Any kind of good internships where you would have actually contributed to a campaign would reflect positively as well. So I would say actual courses that you could do from Facebook, Google, Twitter, and the likes, any kind of first-hand experience working in agencies, whether through an internship or otherwise, and a base broad understanding of marketing. I have another
question. Of course, the basic values of Ice Cube.
Yes, for sure. For sure. हाँ जी व्हाइल स्टार्टिंग अ डीएम एजेंसी अ डिजिटल मार्केटिंग एजेंसी इट इज रेकमेंडेड टू आउटसोर्स सम सर्विसेज और टू डू इट इन हाउस I would say that depends on what you want your agency to do, because today there are hundreds of digital marketing agencies that exist in every market, in every geography. There are agencies in like everything from a Jaipur to everything from like a Gurgaon, Delhi, the biggies, the who's who's. So there are a lot of agencies already which exist. So first, I think it's important to understand what is it that you are going to do uniquely or differently. And other than that, if you can look at based on the answer that you want to give to your clients or based on what you want to stand for your clients, that would answer whether it is you outsource some things or do it in-house. But to be specific again, for our journey, it's not like we started off doing everything in-house. We also used to work with different vendors for things that we didn't know, but we always controlled the creative. See, that was always our focus as Foxy, is that we wanted to be creative and we wanted to be innovators. So those elements of the conversation was always something we used as our differentiators, and we controlled that therefore. If you ask the same question to probably somebody from another agency, they would probably say that we outsourced the creative and we held the tech to us, that we come up with the tech solution and somebody else can do the creative. So depends on what we want to do, why we want to do it, and how that can therefore interplay.
And maybe, you know, what Akanksha is trying to ask is, you know, something related to entrepreneurship, or maybe if she has in mind to start a DM agency.
Yeah. So
of course, you know, every venture should, you know, be solving a particular problem.
Yes.
And that should be your core competency. And then, you know, we always talk about, you know, you have to keep collaborating and expanding.
Yes.
And, you know, so initially, yes, you could get it outsourced if you have the right collaborators.
Yes.
And then slowly, depending upon, you can get into forward integration and backward integration. And that's correct. How you grow.
And I mean, if you're running it as your own business, then obviously you'd see, look at where you're getting how much money from. Right. And if it is a profitable venture for you to take, absorb those skill sets in-house and therefore sell it forward or package it forward as a service that you are providing as an agency. If it makes business sense, that's when you would take it in-house. Like we had, for just to give you an example, Rabbit Hole was Foxy's video production team for the longest time, right? It's only when it reached a certain critical mass after a certain number of years that we decided to make it into a separate standalone production house. So, because it's a gestation of both skills and business, both have to work hand in hand in order for you to be able to make those business decisions.
No doubt about it. Yes, anybody else? So, you know, till somebody else asks a question, you know, one thing very interesting which came out was, and I think the student should know this, that, you know, the digital marketing can be leveraged, you know, in B2B, in B2C, mm-hmm. It could be into, you know, the FMCG industry or all the different types of industries. Mm-hmm. But, and, you know, specifically, all of these students are doing a program. I mean, they have a subject called B2B. They have a subject called distribution and channel management. They have a subject called retailing. So, mm-hmm. You know, if somewhere you could, you know, tie these three, you know, of course, you know, the digital solution for all these three would be different.
Yes.
So if something you can speak about it, maybe it will help them in what they are studying right now.
Sure. So the three were retail, B2B and B2C, right? If I gather correctly. So, I mean, there are different...
So one is distribution, one is retail,
yeah.
And one is, you know, B2B.
Right. So if you look at distribution, retail and B2B, so I would say that distribution would be more specific to like scouting new leads. So for instance, if you're looking at an ecosystem where, you know, you're looking at it from... So for Dharampal Satyapal, for example, DS Corp, we handle their corporate communications. So we handle DS Corp, their Copcom as a mandate. So we handle their LinkedIn page. Now, that's not distribution for DS, but that's got a lot of, I would say a lot of stakeholder involvement, because they do want to look at future investors. They do want to look at future talent. They do want to look at consultants. They do want to look at attracting those side of skill sets into their ecosystems. If you look at it from a distributor specific lens, we've done campaigns for Indian owned businesses, for instance, where which are specifically to within certain one or two states where they want to run Facebook campaigns for every new store launch. So if there is a store that is opened up, then we would run a very micro media targeted campaign to people within that vicinity of the store. So you can set 5 kilometers radius, 10 kilometers radius of that store to try and drive traffic. Now that in a way answers, like looks at distribution and retail in that way as well. Of course, distribution would also be specific to a certain problem, right? Like we've created, for instance, for companies in the past, we've also created dashboards. So where the brand or the organization is allowed to speak to all their distributors or all their vendors together in a more systemized, streamlined, digital sort of way. And of course, there are a lot of channels where you get in more leads. So if you have specific kind of requirements from your brands, they sometimes can reach out to you and say, you know, like, hi, I want ownership, like I want to start this, whether it's from a franchisee model or those kind of things. So those leads, it depends on which platform you're looking at and depends on where those leads are coming in. And finally, I think from a B2B perspective, there's a lot that we do when it comes to, let's say, technology, right? So one of the things that I was referring to, so when Orient Bell Tires, for us, when we built out an entire tech, what it helps them do is it helps architects and designers, interior designers, who are not necessarily, they're not the customer, but they're using an Orient, like a brand generated tool, in order to sell something to their customer, who is somebody building their house. So what the tool enables them to do is they can pick tiles from the website, put it into the sketch of a room, and actually show a render to the client with that, with OBL tiles in the mix, right? Now, does that necessarily mean that that client will only buy Orient Bell Tires? Absolutely not. But it's a tool which facilitates consideration in the minds of that B2B audience. Because then if that architect is dependent on that tool or uses that tool as an interior designer and architect, it's always a positive effect that it's going to have on them. Because the tool is free to use. You just have to come onto the OBL website and use it. And, you know, it facilitates, it helps you have a better pitch to your client. And that's where you're playing the consideration game, therefore impacting it. Similarly, if we have like regional promos and offers. So for instance, last year, I believe Sandisk was doing like Sandisk was doing a retail campaign and they were giving away gold for once a week. They were giving away gold and some laptops and things like that, which is a very offline, typical shop and shop like kind of, differentiating strategy. So we did like a geo-targeted campaign, which wherever these offers were applicable, you can run digital campaigns in and around those areas for those consumer sets to go and visit the store in order to avail this. So it can be something like that as well. So yeah, I mean, I hope that those were examples which gave context, but essentially that. Yes, like retail, retail also, if I remember, like we work with BlackBerry's and we've done this with another brand that I can't remember right now, but wherein if I have ways to target consumers to, of course, drive them into a retail store in a mall, but I can also sit and track and understand which stores are they going into before my store and after my store. So essentially creating like an archetype or a mindset of the consumer by using media, MarTech, marketing technology, as we call it, in order to not just target the consumer, but also differentiate and categorize them into intent. Like, is that person just so searching for things? Or are they actually just window shopping, or are they looking at only shirts, or are they looking at only trousers, things like that, right? So you get a lot of these subtle hints out of different kinds of MarTech as well.
Correct. And I think the real power of digital marketing is that you are able to target your customers specifically. Correct. In a particular geography. And that is where it scores, you know, much ahead than to the traditional marketing tools.
Correct.
So I think you have one more question. Yes. From Kavya.
Hanji, how digital marketing will help financial organizations? How we help in a lot of ways, actually. So one is, of course, simplifying, right? Everybody in BFSI generally, whether look at anybody, ask anyone in your class, ask any of your friends, everybody thinks insurance, oh no, it's not for me. It's not my age to get insurance. I'm not retiring. I don't need to get these kind of products. I don't need to save, or if I'm saving, I'm saving enough in my mom's account. I don't need to save separately. Why should I have mutual funds? Why should I have these kind of things? So digital helps in two ways. One is to create awareness and education around the products and around why they are required. What do you need mutual funds for? What do you need any of these financial products for? Why do you need to use these instruments in your life? That's one aspect of BFSI that you sort of handle in a big way. The second aspect is obviously creating positive consumer interactions. So in a big way, when you look at digital complaints of clients, complaints of customers, you know, just kind of looking at everybody's cribbing about this is not been fulfilled, or my consumer service rep didn't get back to me, or, you know, just looking at people love in India, especially now, people love to tweet about everything and post everything about everywhere. Like, ek kahin to they had a bad exchange with some insurance agent, they will post on all social media handles of that company saying, didn't speak to me, mera claim nahi aaya, ye nahi aaya, wo nahi aaya. So these are, I think, broadly the two big aspects. Of course, there is a large element of performance marketing as well. What I mean by that is, if I know that somebody is on a makemytrip.com, and if somebody is traveling internationally and going to, let's say, a London for a student trip, or, you know, basically looking at student hostels or whatever, then I can, there are multiple ways in which I can track and chase that consumer to sell them travel insurance, right? Similarly, if somebody is looking at loans and they are, you know, on those websites where you're looking at a policy bazaar would be for insurance. If you're looking at a Paisa Bazaar for loans, if you're looking at any of these websites, there are a lot of affiliate campaigns and branding campaigns and marketing campaigns that actually help you track and target that specific customer for a specific need that they had. So you would have largely brand awareness, a large part of performance marketing, and a large part of ORM, like online reputation management, and CRM, customer relationship management, both of these.
So let me introduce you to Dr. Gajendra Sharma, Prachi. So, you know,
good evening, sir.
So I am more of a traditional marketer, but Gajendra sir is more of a digital marketer. So
amazing.
Sir, you are on mute.
Sir, good evening.
Yeah, glad to meet you, ma'am.
Glad to meet you, sir. So please call me Prachi. You all have to stop calling. I'm just Prachi, please. Yes.
So, you know, I started my career in the IT industry, and, you know, it was the IT industry which always spoke of the first names. Mm-hmm. You know, that actually changed the entire scenario. So one feels quite, you know, comfortable in calling out by first names.
Yes.
So students, do you have any more questions for Prachi ma'am?
Good. I think...
sir, आपकी absence में मैंने कुछ कुछ questions पूछ लिए मैम से.
good. So marketers are marketers, whether we call it as digital or traditional marketers.
Yes.
So basic fundamentals तो same ही है. There is same no doubt about it.
Exactly. Yes. Exactly.
Whether we talk about, you know, awareness building or knowing about customer consumer sentiments or performance marketing, they are anyways there. But the tools have changed.
Yeah,
the tools have changed, and I think now the world is, I do not know. I mean, so let me ask Prachi this, you know, we keep talking about the phygital. Okay, so whether when we talk about distribution, when we talk about retailing, so we're going to have e-commerce, we are also going to have physical stores. But when, and similarly, when we talk about marketing, so it's going to be a combination of both, you know, traditional and digital. And we have seen in the past also that, you know, there are times when, you know, TV was at the top, and then you know, it went down, and, you know, or maybe newspaper was the first one to be on top. And then there's always a, you know, kind of a, you know, difference, and the changes keep happening. What do you think are the trends for digital, and how, you know, how long will this survive?
So I don't think there is going to be, we really don't believe that there is going to be multiple agencies. I think it's all moving in the direction of having just one agency, doing everything that you require, which is going to do justice to the consumer. And I don't think there is, there are no rules in absolute. What I mean by that is, it's not that we're going to have, today a consumer can look at a car, a secondhand car on a Cars 24, They can go to, you know, they can speak to their friend about it. They can follow different influencers about it. And they can go buy a secondhand cars anywhere. They could have done all their research on Cars 24, but they could have gone and bought the secondhand car anywhere. Similarly for insurance, similarly for anything that exists. On the converse, you have industries such as makeup, which are extremely active and extremely big when it comes to digital, right? When it comes to beauty, skincare, because it's a packaged product. It's a standardized product. You don't have to worry that much. It's the same. You know what shade you have. You know what shade foundation you are. So for them, the digital journey is very, very simple. You take, you pick, you go. Like, it's not, you know, so much of like trying and all that. That those elements have, they haven't gone away, but it's not as predominant or as physically demanding or required in the day and age. I think the way to look at it is twofold. One is that, as you rightly, what we were talking about is that communication, we're all in the business of communication. That is the point of advertising. The medium and the platform has changed. So from it becoming a monologue to it becoming a dialogue, I think that's in fundamental, it's the easiest way to interpret it. And the dialogue doesn't necessarily only have to be in the form of consumer feedback. The dialogue is also in terms of what they do, right? What we call data positive. Because today, everything that they do on digital is all data positive. So which means that it leaves a data imprint on whichever aspect or wherever they're going. So whether they engage with me on Facebook or they go to my website and do something or they do something on some other website, I can track, trace, and collate all of those experiences into one and build a journey. And to come back to the phygital or the, as we call it, O2O, like offline to online to offline narrative, the consumer journey is no longer linear. What it is multi-dimensional, and there is no way for us to control whether the consumer comes to digital for research or does offline research and then buys online. You can't control that narrative. I think the best way and the best approach is use digital for what it's good and use the other platforms for what they're good. So I always advise my clients that if you're doing a big TV burst, tell me. Not tell me that, oh, you are putting so many crores in that, give me 1 crore. But tell me so that if you're doing a big TV campaign, I can smartly target those audiences using some MarTech technologies and amplifying that user journey. So that that customer who saw your ad on TV doesn't forget about you, but is constantly reminded with different attributes. So I can actually create an entire marketing campaign from start to finish, where you saw the product on TV, then I showed you the different features of the product, then you clicked on Amazon, you went to my Amazon store, you liked what you saw, then I showed you and you made the purchase. And it can also happen the other way around. Like, there are no rules as such. I think it's all about understanding the difference between the monologue and the dialogue and scientifically testing. At the end of the day, that's what digital allows you to do over mainline or over traditional mediums, is to be able to have control mechanisms. Like today, I can go completely media dark in one state and I can do only digital campaigns over there to look at uptake in sales. And therefore, I can build an attribution model for my own self, for my brand, for my category, for my customers. There is no one size fits all and there is no standardization that exists. So it's up to us to build those kind of mechanisms and to build those kind of control and exposed measures to therefore identify what works for our particular brand or service that we're providing.
Yeah, the, you know, to find the ROI has become easier in the digital mode. Mm-hmm. So no doubt. And of course, the pre-purchase journey and the post-purchase journey can be tackled anyway. He may purchase from anywhere, but it is more important to, you know, have control over the pre-purchase journey and the post-purchase journey of the consumer. Mm-hmm. And you can use both the mediums and, you know, and they will keep going hand in hand, no doubt about it.
Yeah, yeah.
Prachi, small question I'd like to ask you. I mean, if you talk about Google AdWords, a friend of mine, you know, he's having his own agency. Mm-hmm. He's doing the same thing. He was telling me that, you know, that Google has changed some kind of an algorithm past few days, you know, due to which a number of campaigns were affected. And clients were not getting that kind of an ROI. So do we have any kind of a mechanism to save our company, our clients, you know, from this kind of a problem?
So the only way I think to do it is information. I don't think there is any way, because at the end of the day, we can't control Google or Facebook or any of these platforms, whether it's Facebook changing its algorithm and the way that it tracks and shows ads to consumers, or it's Google the way that it shows ads, we can't have control over what they do, but we have to have an agility in the way that we tackle it. So if there is, if we do notice, like let's say if we notice a drop in reach or we notice a drop in impressions, it is our responsibility as agencies to track, analyze, research, and inform. So you have to inform the client that, okay, this is what we're seeing, this is what we're noticing, this is what's going to happen, this is what we predict will happen, and these are corrective measures towards it. Like for instance, a couple of years ago, there was a massive drop. Facebook went on like a huge exodus across Facebook and Instagram of cleaning up all the bots, because there were more than millions of bots which were existing across all parts of the world. And they did like a very extensive check. A lot of clients, a lot of brands lost massive amounts of followers. And there's a panic button hit, right? Because it's what they have spent money on building. It is what, like, it's literally you're taking somebody's investment out of their bank and taking it and saying, it's done. It no longer exists. You have taken part of my salary and gone. So when that happens, they are bound to do it. But it is our job as agencies to therefore pass on and be confident of the information that we're passing on, that this is happening as a global or a national or whatever level of phenomena that it is, and have a plan. So if this is happening, what can be done? Should we be reallocating budgets? Should we wait till the tide dies down for a little bit? Like, for example, when in the middle, Zuckerberg was going through a lot of things in the US and the court hearings, a lot of clients, because Nike took a stance, right? And Nike also took a stance against e-commerce. Some other players took a stance against Facebook. And they essentially said, we'll stop listing and we'll stop advertising. Did that trend stick on? Not really. And so at that time, that's the same thing we told our clients, that yeah, one or two people can do it, but nobody's going to get off Facebook, Instagram completely. It is, the ecosystem hasn't evolved. Your consumers, at least in India, are not on so many other platforms where you can reach out to them. So it's not going to die. If you have a global mandate, like some agents, some brands had global mandates that decrease the amount of spends on certain platforms, that's obviously a non-negotiable. But as brand managers itself, so which comes back, if I go back to my vision statement, that we want to be the preferred partner. So being that preferred choice, also a large part of that is having that trust with the agency partner, that you're not going to mess up my business, you're going to tell me the right thing. And so even if that means that we research and come back with the right answer, but that's important. So in that context, it's only pretty much specific to information that you can help with, because you can't control the moves. So how you choose to act upon it is, I think, what you can control.
Very true, very true, very true.
And I think agencies have an onus of, you know, continuously scanning the environment and, you know, getting that marketing intelligence. Yeah. And only then they can survive.
Yeah, of course.
So, Prachi, what is the future of programmatic advertising in India?
So programmatic, so I think it is, there's a long way to go in India. I think when you look at markets such as APAC or where you look at the US and things like that, they are a lot more evolved when it comes to that conversation. Today, when you look at programmatic, it is still, clients pretty much are like, nahin, nahin, ye bahut mehenga hai, without even knowing, understanding, dealing with, or any of those things, right? Without experimenting. So I think there's a huge exercise and effort which currently agencies like ourselves and the larger agencies, everyone's doing, to evangelize programmatic as a product in the ecosystem. So will I use programmatic for a spray and pray approach? No, it's expensive. But will I use programmatic to build an integrated consumer journey? 100%. Right? So it is more, for me, the way I see it, programmatic is more middle of the funnel than top of the funnel or bottom of the funnel. Because your top will still require that kind of largeness and cheaper CPM, versus your bottom will require a lot of optimization and real-time optimization. So I feel like the middle journey of a brand is where I would personally, if I had to, that's where I would see programmatic being the most useful for me in campaigns. But yeah, I mean, in India, it's a long way from being
long
there.
Way to go.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So I think if there are no more questions, can we request these students, if they can switch on their cameras, we can have a selfie with Prachi.
So sweet.
Friends, please switch on our videos.
So quickly, guys.
रेश, रितिक, शिवांग, सूरज, तुहिन, हर्षल, कोई एक बच्चे? Amisha is the first one. Okay, good.
So Amisha gets, yes, she gets 5 more marks in her internal assessment.
Yeah. Amisha, you belong to which section?
Sir, I'm 3.
Oh. Krish, Tuhin, Shalvi, bhai, quickly, can you please switch on your cameras?
What is the delay like here? Come on. चलो मैम, इतने में कर रहे हैं, एक क्वेश्चन एक दिमाग में और आ रहा है, लाइक यू नो जनरली वी से यू नो वी आर नॉट सेलिंग अ प्रोडक्ट, वी आर सेलिंग अ स्टोरी. सो दिस पोस्ट कोविड 19 हम अक्सर बात करते हैं ड्यूरिंग द कोविड 19. मेरा क्वेश्चन दूसरा है, मैं ये जानना चाहता हूँ कि पोस्ट कोविड 19 व्हाट विल बी द स्टोरी लाइन, हाउ वी आर गोइंग टू सेल अ प्रोडक्ट यूजिंग अ स्टोरी, आई मीन व्हाट वुड बी द वेरियस नुआंसेस और निटी-ग्रिटीज.
Gajendra sir, I have a message from Janvi. I think that Prachi has another okay, meeting, okay, which is lined up. Okay, so I think okay. she
sure,
so
sure, maybe, sure, sure, sure.
I have a 6:30. But sir, very quickly, if I was to answer that, there is no. If you ask me, there is no change in narrative. I don't think I would never advise my brands to even take on the narrative of COVID unless you are specifically in that domain, unless you're like a hospital or a medical or like, you know, something which has actually assisted or made an impact in the pandemic. Otherwise, I think it's pretty much business as usual in terms of the art of storytelling or the way that we're telling, we're communicating and things like that. Because as I said, like most of the country, most of the world is opening up and whether we like it or not, it is here to stay. It's not going to go away. It is a reality today. And so therefore, either if, as I said, be involved in the conversation and the narrative, if you have actually contributed to it, not as a marketing opportunity. I don't think it should be looked at by any brand for that matter as a marketing specific opportunity. And I think, which is what the second wave saw, right? In the first wave, we had a lot of, Seva heroes and like doing like a lot of brands basically shouting out and like saying something about the way that everyone has reacted to it or encouraging those things. I think the second wave pretty much saw the abolishment almost of that because everybody was very sensitive to it that, listen, unless you have a serious thing to say, please don't say it. Don't dilute the nature of a pandemic by just being topical about it. It's not a topic. You know, it's not a moment that you use moment marketing on. It's not a topical that you kind of do a topical update on. It's a grave reality of what happened to the world. And so, yeah, I mean, from a narrative point of view, that's what it would be. It's not specifically anything per se that has changed. I think you have just rules and regulations, like if you're showing a crowded place, show masks. Those are just basic sensitivities. But I think the human emotions still remain the same.
I think so. How we take it? बच्चों को शर्म आ रही है लगता है.
देखो फॉक्सी 5 है और हम अभी यहाँ पे 5 ही हैं, तो इसलिए सही सही बात है, कोई दिक्कत वाली बात नहीं है.
No, it's all good, it's all good.
Thank you so much Prachi, and it was a pleasure listening to you.
It was my pleasure being here. Thank you.
You know, the kind of joy and enthusiasm you have when you are speaking, that's what, you know, we always tell our students. So, जो एक marketeer है, तो उसमें तो वो joy और enthusiasm तो होना ही चाहिए.
होना ही चाहिए.
And you know, I could see that in when you were presenting. So, hats off to you, and thank you so much.
Thank you. Thanks a lot, Sachi. Thank you for having me. Have a great evening, everybody.
You too. Cheers. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye.